Amen. That was wonderful, right? So, yeah. Well, thank you all for being here with us today. My name is John. I'm the assistant pastor here, and it's awesome to be in the house of the Lord together with you today. So I bring greetings from our lead pastor and his wife, Pastor Carl and Pastor Sandra. They are currently ministering in Zambia, Africa, right now. They have been there for just about 2 weeks. They come home this week. They have been launching into new Bible schools there. We launched about 40 2 years ago. And of those 40 Bible schools that we launched 2 years ago, there have been 105 graduates that they got to do a graduation with. These are ministers of the gospel, pastors, leaders. Amen, amen. People that are going to be spreading the gospel to additional people, so churches. They're going back to plant churches. So literally thousands of lives are being touched because of that work. And while they're there, they're launching 35 to 40 new Bible schools as well that will be touching more lives as those other ones continue on. It is so exciting that we as Reach Out Church get to partner with the Lord to accomplish this great work of sending the gospel out to the nations. So this is awesome that, you know, Reach Out Church in little old Hyde Park, New York here. We're making an impact around the world, and we do this in the DR. We do this in Zambia, in Haiti, and it's awesome that because of you as the church, you guys giving and supporting this, we're able to do this around the world. So thank you so much for all that you do to participate. So thank you. That's wonderful. So we're going to hear all about that trip when they come back. Next week, Pastor Carl will be back again, and we're super excited to hear the report of what God did there. So it's awesome. So today, I want to dive into a word that I believe God's put on my heart. So I, as normal, you guys who have been here, you know I usually like to open up with a story. So I want to tell you a short story here, and this is something that happens in my house. I have a 5-year-old daughter and a 3-year-old daughter. So what... Yeah, they're a ton of fun. But how it goes is their whole lives, ever since they were able to talk, if they asked me for something, specifically a food item, if they want, you know, something like a fruit snack or M&Ms or anything like that, if I give it to them, I open it up and I hand it to them, and then I'll always take one out first and say, taxes, and then I'll eat it and hand them the rest, right? Train them young, right? So it's gotten to the point for them that now whenever they ask for something, they'll literally say, Dad, can you get me such and such, and please don't take taxes? I say, isn't that our heart too, right? Please don't take taxes. Yeah, tax day's coming up, right, tomorrow, so painful area, I know. But so they ask that. So occasionally I'll give it to them, and what I've started to do is I'll give it to them without taking anything out of it, but then I'll let a few moments linger, and I'll say, hey, could I have one of those? Can I have a piece? And when I first started doing this, it was amazing to see how they would clutch it tighter, hold it close to them like it's the most precious thing in the world, and be like, no, not this. Yeah. Meanwhile, I know I could go get my own, I could get 30 more, but there's something special about sharing in that with them, right? You who are parents can understand that. It's like, yeah, you know, I want them to do it. So just this week, I had this amazing moment with my youngest daughter, Amelia. I gave her a pack of M&Ms, I let a few moments go by, and I asked her if I could have one. And then she looks at the M&Ms, looks at me, looks at the M&Ms again, looks back at me. And then she looks down and starts poking around in the M&Ms, and she pulls one out and says, here, Dad, it's blue, your favorite color, for you. And she gives it to me. It was the sweetest little thing, and I'm like, oh, melt in my heart. Made me feel so much a part of it. Not only did she give me back what I asked for, but she intentionally gave me something that was special to me. And it just melted me. It just blew me away. I was like, wow, this is amazing that she did this. And then I started thinking and wondering, is this how God interacts with us maybe a little bit too? That he's inviting us. He's saying, hey, I'm asking you to give me back out of what I've given to you. And we, at times, maybe clutch it like my daughters used to and say, no, it's mine. I can't believe you would ask me to give this. And then other times we're like, yeah, you've given me so much. It's such a joy to give back to you. And we partner with him in that, and we experience the pleasure and the joy of that as well. And there's all these dynamics at work. And so I open today's message with asking, where are you at when God asks you to partner with him, when he asks you to give back out of what he's given you? And I'm not even just talking about finances. I'm not talking about any of that. Because last week, we went over a message that was all about the principle of partnership. It's about getting in the yoke with Christ. And in that, we focus primarily on the things we add to the load, the things that we have to cast off that are holding us back because God never asked us to carry it, and it's causing us to be weary, worn out. If you didn't get a chance to check it out or listen to it, it is online. I encourage you to check it out. But today, we're going to focus on the other half of that. Because last week, like I said, we focused on getting rid of the load that we're carrying that we were never designed to carry. This week, I want to focus on what is Christ's burden? Because he invites us to carry a burden with him. He says, my burden is light, my yoke is easy. And he invites us to carry. So it's a light burden, it's an easy burden, and we discussed that in detail last week, so we're not going to go over that again today. But there is still a burden. So what does Christ's burden, what does carrying Christ's burden look like for us today? And that's what I want to dive into, and I believe this will help bring some clarity and help us in our this awesome. And it's found in the book of Luke, and it's in chapter 19. And we're going to turn to it in just a minute. But there's two things, I'll give you a little spoiler alert, two things we're honing in on today. The first one that we know Christ is concerned about, that's a major part of his burden, is salvation, right? Which is bringing people to a relationship with God. He came and he died on the cross, died for our sins so we could be reconciled, so we could be brought into a relationship with God. Many of you, there was about 7 or 8 people that made that decision for the first time last week, and that was amazing. And we'll give another invitation throughout the service today where if you haven't done that yet, you'll be able to if you would like to do that. Because that begins the journey. That begins you walking with God and experiencing the main purpose he has for your life, which is to have a relationship with him. And the second thing that he's concerned about is transformation. Because he designed us to be like Christ. He's called us to be like Christ. And that's a denying of our flesh and submitting to the Spirit and walking in his ways, his principles. Not because he wants to control you, not because he wants to dominate you, but because he knows what's best for you. And he has a great plan for your life, and he's got a great future for you. But to attain that future, that destiny he has for you, you have to submit to doing it his way. And that's what he's called us to do. And that requires transformation on our end. So, this passage talks a lot about this. So it's Luke chapter 19, starting at verse 1. And it says, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. I can identify with that, right? So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him. Since Jesus was coming that way, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner? But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back 4 times the amount. Then Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. All right. So there's 3 main things that just jump out at me during this story that I believe God wants to put his finger on for our lives today. The first point that I want to start with is that Jesus notices those who seek him. And those of you who have come into a relationship with Jesus, you can attest to this, right? All of a sudden, one day, you said yes to him, you invited him into your heart, and you knew you mattered to God. You began a relationship with him. Your life was never the same. Because Jesus, the creator of the universe, the one that died for your sins, noticed you. And that's powerful. The scripture in different places calls us Christ's ambassadors to the world, which means we represent him to the people we interact with. If we've committed to being a Christ follower, we've committed to that relationship. It means we represent Christ to those people. So it's safe to assume, safe to put into practice that God has called us to notice those that are seeking him as well. And think about what a gift this is, right? That we get to notice people on behalf of Christ. Before we had kids, my wife and I went to two concerts right in a row within a couple nights of each other. One in a real like intimate, closed setting where we were right up against the stage, probably like 50 to 100 people in it for this pretty popular band. And then we went to the Barclays Center a couple nights after that, and the same band was playing there as well. And at the Barclays Center, we were much more removed from the stage. So we're up in kind of the middle range there, and my wife was off to one side by the railing. And she's there enjoying the music, and then all of a sudden, the lead singer glanced over in her direction and pointed up and like nodded his head with a big smile, like an acknowledgement, like he recognized her. She was on cloud nine the whole like next 2 days. She's like, "He noticed me. Did you see that? He pointed right at me." Whether it was or not, there's some fuzziness to that, but it made her light up. And it's the same with Christ, that when God notices him, this happened to Zacchaeus in this story. Jesus says, Zacchaeus, he calls him by name, invites him down, says, "I must go to your house today. I've got to spend some time with you." And we have the opportunity to share that same gift with the people in our lives that are seeking Christ. And we're called to do this. This is part of carrying the burden that Jesus has for us, is to notice those that are seeking Christ. So what does it look like when somebody's seeking Christ? What are the signs, the evidence that there are people that should be noticed? Well, we see in Zacchaeus' case here, he was probably corrupt. He was a bit of an outcast. In those days, the tax collectors were hated by the Jewish people because they worked for their oppressors, the Romans, and they betrayed their people to collect taxes on their behalf and pay it to them. Often they would cheat people and charge more than they needed to build their own wealth. So they were often hated by the Jewish people. And then the Romans looked down on them because they had betrayed their own people. And they didn't trust them fully either. They were just kind of chasers of money. So they didn't trust them either. So they were very much loners. The only other people that would hang out with them were the people that were the same as them. So sometimes the people that are looking for Jesus might be a little flawed, might be a little corrupt, might be a little rough around the edges.
No, we're rough.
Kind of like you and me, right? Kind of like you and me. And it's easy to judge. It's easy to say, "Oh, I don't think they're really seeking God." But if you take the time to notice them, you can find out. Are they drawn to God? Are you giving them the space and the time to notice them as Jesus noticed you? As he noticed Zacchaeus in this story? Because he's called us to represent him to this world, to those that are seeking him. There's a promise that God makes in James chapter 4, verse 8. On the first half of it, it says, if you draw near to God, he will draw near to you. So that means salvation is available for anyone that will turn their focus to God, which is good news. Because that means we don't get to pick. We don't say, okay, they're good enough, or they're got the right actions or attitudes or whatever. But rather, Jesus says, listen, all are welcome. All they have to do is choose to follow me. Choose to commit their life to me. Live it my way. We're going to pause right here before I even move into the next point. Because I don't know everybody here. Maybe you're here and you're saying, that sounds good. I've never committed my life to Christ. I've never made that decision to say, I want to follow Jesus. I want that. That sounds amazing. And it is amazing. We're talking more, you'll hear through the rest of this message, the part that we play in that, the burden, the part that we carry in this. But Jesus did the heavy lifting. He died in your place. He took the place of your punishment for your sins on the cross so that you can experience salvation. You can experience a relationship with God. Reconciliation to God. So right now, I want to ask that we just bow our heads, close our eyes. There's nothing magical about this. This is just to help keep any distractions out of sight. But if you're here today and you want to make a commitment to Christ, you want to say, Jesus, I want your help to live my life your way, just raise your hand up in the air. Okay, I see that hand. Thank you. I see that hand back there. See that hand? Great. Awesome. Awesome. I see that hand back there. Thank you. Thank you so much. What we're going to do as a church is we're going to take a moment to just say a prayer. Because this is to verbalize, it says in Romans 10, or yeah, I believe it's Romans 10, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So we're doing a verbal expression of our belief, of the inward belief we have in our heart, that Jesus died on the cross, rose again, and came into our life. So let's do that together. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you so much for taking the place of my punishment. Because I've made mistakes, and I need you to save me. I invite you to come into my life and lead me in your ways. I want to live the rest of my days for you and according to your ways. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, guys. This is amazing. Those three or four hands. Amen. Amen. I want to invite you, if you did raise your hand, please come and see me after the service right up here at the front. I just want to talk with you a little bit about the next steps. It won't take long, I promise, but I just want to talk with you about that because I believe it'll help you in your walk with God. But thank you so much for making that decision today. God is going to bless you as a result of that. I'm convinced of it. Amen. All right. So, we're called to notice those who are seeking him, just as Jesus did. And number two, and this is a big one, Jesus always makes it about the person he's ministering to rather than the appearance of it. Boiled down or said another way is Jesus was more concerned about doing good than looking good, right? In an age we live in with Instagram and all of this stuff where everything's curated to look perfect, which I've loved personally about the recent like Instagram versus reality clips and videos that I've seen recently, that it's like, oh yeah, on Instagram it looks all perfect, but then they show you the behind the scenes of like, okay, this corner of my house looks perfect, but the rest of the room is just a disaster setting up that one little corner, right? You know, so it's like Instagram versus reality, that reality, it still is a bit of a mess, right? Where we don't have to look perfect, we don't have to act perfect, we don't have to be perfect, because we're walking with God and we're figuring things out too, right? We don't have it all together. I'm not perfect, you're not perfect. We don't need to look perfect. We need to be honest about that and be willing to help people do what God has called them to do, to get the hope, the healing, and the wholeness. I'm so glad that I'm part of a church that cares about that, that we are here to reach the lost, to train them up and to send them out, that we're committed to hope, healing, and wholeness, which means we're broken people here together. We have flaws, we have damaged areas, we have things going on in our lives, but we're all pursuing Christ in the midst of that and looking to him for our healing and our wholeness, because he has that for us, amen? Can I confess something to you? For too long in my marriage, was I really good at pointing out the flawed thinking that my wife had. The flaws that I felt she, if she just tweaked this or just did this better, God could really move in this area. Right? Yeah, exactly. Not me, yeah. Oh, no, I have it figured out, right? But I didn't. There's a verse that talks about this. We're going to turn to it. And it's in Matthew chapter 7. Starting at verse 3, it says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? Right. How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. It is so easy to find the flaws, find the faults in the people around us, right? I can look at them, I can see them, and I can say, oh, yeah, if only they figured this out, this, this, and this, their life would be great. There's this amazing passage in Acts chapter 10 and 11 where God confronts a flawed thought, a flawed worldview in the disciple Peter's life. Now, Peter walked with Jesus. He literally lived with him for the earthly ministry he had for the 3+ years he was here. He did everything alongside of him. Then Jesus dies. He raises again. God uses Peter to initiate basically Pentecost happening and 3,000 people coming to Christ and the church being born. That all happened because Peter said yes to him and God moved mightily in his life. And then chapters later in Acts, we find that God confronts this flawed thinking he had. That flawed thinking was that he assumed that the power of God through the work of the Holy Spirit was only available to the Jewish people. He had this racist thinking about him. And I was praying and asking God about this and saying, God, why didn't you address this when you were walking with him? Why'd you wait till Acts chapter 10 to bring this up? What's going on with that? And then I started to have some understanding where when I came to know Christ, he didn't come into my life and then give me a laundry list of things to get better at. He didn't do that to you either. He came in and he said, okay, you're dealing with this crisis. Let me help you with that. Let's change this. This is the principle. Apply this to your life and this area is going to get better. And he helped you walk through that. And then it got better. Then life went on a little bit and you had another crisis, another conflict, another area come up, and God put his finger on it and said, yeah, you know what? You're holding on to unforgiveness to this person. You're doing this wrong. But this will help you in this crisis. And then that one got fixed because you submitted to Christ, and it got better because you get better at life when you start doing it God's way. And then another area comes up, and he deals with that as it comes up. Could you imagine how overwhelmed you would be if he came and said, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong? And yet I was doing that with my poor wife. Can you believe this? He has not called us to do this. And often, if I'm being honest, I was doing that to avoid the plank in my eye. I was doing that to avoid the issue that God was putting his finger on in me and saying, you need to deal with this. I had an amazing illustration of this come up this very week. So I'm putting my oldest daughter to bed. And she was asking me to tell her a story, so she'll do that sometimes. And I'm about this close from her face, just telling her the story as we're snuggled up there, laying in the bed, telling her the story. And then all of a sudden, she had a little piece of dust or dirt or something fall right near her eye. I said, Chloe, don't move. You've got a little speck there. Let me help get that out for you. She says, no, Dad, I got it. And she starts going like this, rubbing it in, you know, making it worse, getting it all irritated. I said, Chloe, stop. I literally grabbed her hand and pulled it away. I said, stay still a second. Let me help you with this. And I gently took my finger, swiped it away. No irritation, no conflict. It was fixed. And God spoke to me and he said, if you're unwilling to get involved in the mess, you have no room to speak of it. If you see a speck in somebody's eye and you're not willing to participate in helping them walk through that, because you don't know the trauma, the years of baggage that have led to that moment for that little speck. But maybe God's prompting you and saying, listen, help them. And that's not just saying, oh, you've got this area. Because that's not helping anybody, right? They're like, yeah, I know. I've been carrying that for 20 years. But if we're willing to say, hey, you know what? I dealt with something similar to that. This helped me a lot. Let me know if I can help walk with you through this. All of a sudden, that's transformational. That's helpful because now you're getting into the mess with them and saying, listen, I'm not going to judge you for this because I've been here too, but I'm willing to walk with you as long as it takes to help get the freedom that God has for you in this. Not judging you because whether you fix it today or 10 years, 20 years, 30 years from now, I'm going to love you like Christ loves you. And it's not my love. God's love is not contingent upon your performance. He loves you no matter what, but he has a better way. And as you continue to submit to his better way, you're going to experience the freedom he has for you. So as he's putting his finger on those specks, on those planks in your eyes, focus on you. Do what God's told you to do. And then we can help, like the end of this passage talks about. Then we can see clearly to help remove the speck, to get into the mess with them, and to walk alongside of the body of Christ as God has called us to do. Now, again, I'm so thankful that I'm part of a church that we care about doing good more so than just looking good. We know we're flawed. We know we have some areas that need God's touch, his healing touch. And you don't have to be ashamed of that. You don't have to hide that. We'll walk with you through that. This is what we're called to do here. Even before I continue, I feel like there's some individuals here, you've been carrying shame for some issues you've had, some flaws you've seen in your own life, and you're ashamed of it, and you feel you're hiding it, you're carrying this for too long. And God's saying to you today, come to me, get hope, get healing, and you'll experience the wholeness I have for you. But you can't experience that when you keep it in the dark. I think of like, if you have a clay vase of some kind, right? And you're looking at it in the dark, it probably looks pretty good and stuff. But then all of a sudden, if you shine a flashlight on it, you can see the exposure, the cracks, the damaged areas, the flaws in it. So there's a tension point of saying, okay, if I come into the light, if I expose it, everybody's going to see that. So I need to hide this so nobody knows. But the reality is, if you submit to doing good, you're going to bring it to be exposed so you can get repaired. So you can experience the healing touch that the Maker, Jesus Christ, has for you. So don't hide in shame any longer. Because we all have cracks, we all have flaws, we all have damaged areas in our lives that we're looking to Christ to bring healing to. You don't have to hide. You don't have to keep it back. You can bring that because we're here to help walk through. We're not here to judge. We're here to help walk through those areas with you. So you don't have to hide any longer. Jesus talks about this in Mark chapter 2, verse 17. He talks about this in all of the synoptic gospels, the Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And he gets confronted by the Pharisees and says, why do you hang out with sinners and tax collectors and these bad people? This is what Jesus had to say. Mark chapter 2, verse 17. On hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners, of which I am, of which you are. If a doctor just hangs around healthy people the whole time, he's not actually accomplishing his purpose to bring health to the sick. And God has called us to be around sick people because we ourselves have been there, right? So let's bring healing. Let's represent him well. Let's do this together. Because we need to focus on doing good more so than looking good. All right. Our third and final point for today is being around Jesus causes us to confront our issues. I talked about bringing that vase to the light, right? And then you see the issues, the stuff in it. And once Jesus was around Zacchaeus, he just happened to be there. He didn't tell him all the things he was doing wrong. Didn't tell him he needed to stop ripping people off or stop being corrupt or stop doing this or that. It was just there. And all of a sudden, being in the presence of Jesus compelled Zacchaeus to want to be better and want to do better. And he says, look, I'm going to give half my stuff away just because I need to do better. If I've ripped anybody off, I'm going to repay it four times the amount. When we're in the presence of God, we can't help but be transformed. For those of you who accepted Christ today, and if you've done that at any point in your life, you understand the verse that talks about you are a new creation, the old has passed away, and behold, all things have been made new. You sense a difference within you because your spirit has been made alive in Christ. I've often heard this compared to a caterpillar metamorphosizing into a butterfly, right? They come from the same thing, but they're completely different creatures. And it's the same for us. I actually did some research this week. I was looking it up. Did you know caterpillars eat green leaves and stuff like that, but butterflies have a completely different appetite than caterpillars do. They don't eat the same things. They go after the nectar. Their mouths are formed completely different. They cannot physically eat the same things. And it's the same for us. When we're transformed, when we're brought into that new life that salvation brings, we have been changed. We can't satisfy our flesh the same way we used to. Because we're not called to. We're called to satisfy the Spirit now. The issue in that, though, is that some of us as Christians, we still carry some of our caterpillar thinking. right? We're walking around with that saying, oh, I remember what that leaf tasted like. That was good. But it's not good anymore. Because God has better for you. He's changed your appetites. He's changed your being. You're no longer that same person. So let's submit to Him. Let's say, okay, I need to get into His presence to continue to renew my mind. There's a verse that talks about this in Romans chapter 12. Very popular verse, starting at verse 1. It says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. This is what we sang about with our special today. That our life be surrendered to Him. So we can say, God, have your way in me and through me. Because I see I've got issues. I've got things that I need healing for. I know I need to carry your burden. And He says, great. Come to me. As we talked about last week, come to me, all you who are weary, and I will give you rest. So let's choose to do it His way today. Let's carry His burden, which all boiled down, His burden is for people. He said it right at the start, to seek and to save that which was lost. He's concerned about their salvation and transformation. And that's what He wants for you. That's what He wants for me. And when we get into His presence, we continue to be transformed. We continue to expose those areas of our life that are flawed and damaged that we need to confront and say, okay, God, what do I do now? And He says, all right, apply this principle. Do this. Read this passage. This will help you in that. Talk with somebody about it. Do different things. He'll give you the strategy as you present the need to Him. Because He's got good things for you. Because He loves you. At this point, I want to invite you to stand to your feet. We're going to begin to close here, but something I always invite you to do before I close a message is to ask the Holy Spirit, what are you speaking to me through this message? Because we're all in different areas, different stages of our life, different walks. So I invite you to say that even right now as we begin to pray together. Just ask Him, Holy Spirit, what are you speaking to me through this message? Lord Jesus, I thank You for the individuals that are here in this place today, that are here to say yes to You. Lord, we know You have a burden for us to carry, and it is light, it is easy. So help us to align with that burden today, to notice those that are seeking You, to make it about doing good rather than just being good or looking good. That we would pursue Your presence, knowing that in Your presence is where we are changed the most. So Lord Jesus, I ask that You would reveal to each and every person here the area that they're to focus on in their lives today. That if there's any planks in our eyes, that You would help us to remove them today, Lord Jesus. So that we can see clearly to help those that are in need. I thank You for this group of people that are here, each and every individual. I ask that You would bless them as they go about their week, as they continue to pursue You in each and every area of their life. Help expose those areas so they can experience the hope and the healing and the wholeness. Give them the next steps that they need to take to experience that in You, Lord. We thank You for it. In Your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you would like prayer for anything, please feel free to come up to the front. We would love to pray with you. God bless you.